Welcome to another episode of Consumer Protection and You with Ryan Libby. Today, we're going to be looking at something that happens throughout the summer months, and that's going to fairs and how we can protect ourselves from getting scammed. Stay tuned. Welcome back to another episode of Consumer Protection and You with Ryan Libby. Ryan Libby is a consumer educator with the State of Ohio Attorney General's Office, Dave Yost. Ryan, it's always a pleasure. You know, we're right into the summer months.
I can feel it outside. It's a beautiful day, and hopefully people are watching on an equally beautiful day. So thanks for having me.
Well, I think it's great. You know, as we get out and about, a lot of different things happen during the summer months. And it's interesting, fair season throughout state of Ohio occurs at this time. And I've always found myself wondering, how safe are they? You know, you see individuals that look a little shady. and you wonder, how safe are you?
Absolutely. Well, the good news is, you know, I think most businesses, most exhibitors mean well and are there to do the right thing. And any charity asking for money at the fair, hopefully, has your best interests in mind. But, you know, the last couple of years we've had COVID. And because of the pandemic, unless you had a child that was a junior fair exhibitor or something like that, you may not be in the practice of keeping your guard up when you're at the state fair or at the county fair or at your local independent fair. So it's time to get those antennas up and to look at the red flags of when somebody might be trying to scam you or be a little less than legitimate at a fair. Because let's face it, you know, just like online, nobody can vet all the exhibitors and all of the showmen and all of the carnival folks and everybody else 100%. I mean, there's bound to be some wrongdoing in terms of consumer protection issues at some of these fairs, at least some of the time. So the onus is on us to learn how to protect ourselves. And of course, the Ohio Attorney General's Office Consumer Protection Section always stands ready if there's a pattern or a practice of unfair business conduct. Please let us know. And in fact, I guess at this point, I'll give our toll-free number and our website. So if you do see something, say something. At least let us know what's happening. Even if we aren't able to put a stop to it in time, at least we know enough to be educated for the next go around. Or, you know, some folks may travel around to different fairs. So if they're not on the up and up at one fair, we might be able to catch them before they get to the next county. Our website is www.ohioprotects.org. That's www.ohioprotects.org. And our toll-free number for the Help Center, no matter what section you're looking for at the Attorney General's office, your one stop for the Help Center is 800-282-0515. 800-282-0515. I've just got a few bullet points in terms of what to look out for at your fair. Now, when you're dealing with sweepstakes and drawings and giveaways, everybody's sort of in the mode of trying to sign up and give out their personal information. And in return, you might win a basket or you might win a door prize or something like that. And I'm here to sort of be the skeptic and say, do you really need to get into each and every contest you're able to enter? Because you want to read the entry form you sign, especially the small print, because many times the company or whoever's doing the drawing will use these entry forms as a marketing tool. So you might be on the do not call registry, which is good, but the contest you may be entering might give them permission to call you. And you may even be consenting to the sale of your personal information to other companies or other organizations. So it's really important to read the fine print. And if you're not sure walk away. Or if you're not sure, ask someone behind the desk, what are you going to be doing with my personal information? And it's always better safe than sorry. If you have any kind of qualm or any kind of distaste in your mouth when it comes to what kind of information they're asking for, don't provide it. And make sure that you tell other folks and warn them that they need to read the fine print and know what they're signing up for before they give out their birth date and their full address and whatever other information they're asking for. Can sometimes be resold or used to market you for months in the future. So it's just important to beware and be a little skeptical when you're trying to sign up for those drawings and sweepstakes. Also, you want to be skeptical of the so-called free vacation offers. You know, it sort of goes back to our mantra, if it sounds too good to be true, it probably is. Many times there's strings attached to what they say are free or bargain travel offers. You might have to purchase an expensive second ticket, or you might have to listen to a long-winded sales pitch. So know all the details before you sign up for any kind of vacation offer, travel package, anything like that, especially if you haven't had time to research it. I mean, even if you are at the fair, you're still able to use your smartphone if you have a smartphone, do a little research, or when in doubt, walk away or get information about how you might be able to sign up in the privacy of your own home or once you've done some due diligence before you commit to anything. Some of these offers may have so many conditions, restrictions, and hidden costs that you can't possibly schedule the trip, even though you've already committed to paying for it or even given your money out. So again, if it sounds too good to be true, it probably is.
You have, of course, the midway, the rides. The second thing that you have is the animals. The third thing is the games. And we'll get to the games in a little bit. And then the fourth thing is businesses that are in like shelter barns or someplace where you pass through. And I've always encouraged small businesses to look at the possibility of sitting and renting a space. So most of the scams that you're talking about appear to come from that business place where people
walk probably by. Probably, but let's keep in mind that sometimes businesses may see themselves trying to attract a different audience or wanting to be without the competition that you might have in the business or the commerce barn or hall. So you may even see a free vacation offered in the midway or on your way in or on your way out. So they might try to catch you coming, catch you going. For the most part, the businesses are contained in what's hopefully an air-conditioned area, or at least with a house fan, in a barn or in a building of their own. And that's, then everybody going in there sort of knows to have their antennas up when they go into that kind of a sales pitch environment.
Who is really responsible for the safety of the individuals in county fairs? Is the state of attorney general's office responsible for the safety of the different county fairs?
Well, in terms of physical safety, obviously that's a different story. That could be the county sheriff's department. It could be the state highway patrol at the state fair. But when we're talking about consumer protection issues, we always have our antennas up and we're always looking for the potential for consumer harm through the state fair, through the city county fairs, the independent fairs. These are gathering places for whole counties or whole regions or whole states. So it is ripe for the possibility. It's not 100%, but it's ripe for the possibility that someone may be there with less than credible intentions. So it's really important that we understand as the Attorney General's office that we want to make sure we're protecting the unprotected, as the Attorney General Yost would say. We want to make sure that we are there making sure that the Consumer Sales Practices Act and the 20 some other bigger consumer laws that are on the books in the state of Ohio are adhered to. The spirit and the letter of the law are adhered to, so Ohioans are protected. So if you see something, say something, because just because it happens at the fair doesn't mean it's going to stop at the fair. I mean, these people run businesses potentially year round. They may be traveling a circuit that has them showing up at other Ohio fairs in the coming months. So it's really important that if you see something awkward or if you see something that doesn't ring true to you, to let others know, especially our office. So that phone number again, 800-282-0515, or let us know through the web at ohioprotects.org. And those are really good resources for you, not just during fair time, but all year round. I mean, we have the help center up and running every business day of the year. So we want to make sure people feel comfortable letting us know or letting us hear of any tips you may have about any unfair business practices.
I think that as individuals that go to county fairs, first of all, they assume that the games where you can win little dolls or bears, teddy bears, et cetera, are rigged and fixed. Care to comment on that?
That's not really my expertise in terms of the games of skill, the games, you know, but there is skill involved. I mean, that's why you're there to try to win a prize, is because there is skill involved. So are there tricks, are there tips, are there best practices in trying to win a game of skill? Absolutely. The carnival workers themselves are often experts at their own games, and they'll show you how easy it is, at least from where they stand, to win a prize. But not sure that we've really run into a lot of rigging. But certainly if they gave a stuffed animal or a big, huge prize to everybody, they wouldn't be in business very long unless they were charging $30 or $40 to enter. So obviously it can be difficult to win. It's sort of buyer beware. If you have problems, let me know. But, you know, one time, for example, it was at a fair. And it wasn't even in the state of Ohio. This was actually in the state of New Jersey, I believe. But I was trying to win a prize, and it was had to do with putting softballs in a fruit basket. And there was a little sign that said no leaning that I never saw. And I went through and I got all my balls in the basket. Then the worker says, oh, sir, you were leaning, so you're not eligible for the prize. And I said, well, look how small this is. And you didn't catch me during the game. You didn't tell me the precaution of don't lean. So he gave me the prize. I didn't really make a big deal about it. Neither did he. And I got a big stuffed animal out of the deal. So I'm sure he liked the fact that I was carrying it around, because it was the beginning of my fair trip. And so I had to carry it all around the fair with me, which I'm sure the carnival workers love, because it shows that people actually do win. And, you know, another old adage that I heard growing up was that they have people walk around with those big stuffed animals only to get people to play the games, that those weren't really winners. Those were just people that are part of the con. Well, the games aren't really cons. And if you have a problem, contact, you know, if there is law enforcement there, if you run into a big issue with your safety or with any game of skill, certainly you can ask them what you might want to do, but feel free to give us a call or let us know over the web if you see something wrong or see something untoward about what you're facing at the fair. But for the most part, you know, we want to keep safety in mind, and we're there to have fun, but don't let your guard down in terms of consumer protection. Keep your guard up, keep your information to yourself if you can possibly muster giving up on some of those sweepstakes, and at least read the fine print and privacy policies before signing up for any mailing lists or providing your contact information.
I know that county fairs seem to be the spotlight on different games of chance, as well as the business halls where you can go in and buy certain kinds of things. But I think also there are amusement parks that cater to similar kinds of situations. There are church bazaars or church programs. Do the laws apply to one and all, or are there different laws based upon who you are and where you come from?
Well, I would think that the law is pretty much applied equally to, you know, is if the setting is similar. The one thing I do want to you want to bear in mind is when you're asked to buy a product or if you're given a sales pitch at a fair, that is typically not the seller's regular place of business. It's sort of triggering a usually a three-day cancellation period. So that is unique to any place outside of the salesperson's regular place of business. So if he's going to a home improvement expo or a state fair or a county fair, usually they have to give you notice that you have 3 days to cancel the contract or cancel the sale. So they shouldn't be starting work right away if it involves work. They should be giving you a form that clearly states that you're able to cancel the transaction within 3 business days of signing up. And that's something specific to things that are at expos or door-to-door or anything outside of the business's regular place that they have as their headquarters. So it's really important that you know about your cancellation rights. And if they don't provide it, ask them about it. And if they refuse to give you any acknowledgement, let us know at the Attorney General's office so we potentially could maybe look into whether they ought to be bound by that 3-day right to cancel. And the whole reason behind the right to cancel and the reason why it's part of the Home Solicitation Sales Act in the state of Ohio, it's sort of like a cooling off period, because they realize when people are approached door to door or when they're approached at a county fair or state fair, they may not have all the research tools available to them. They may not be thinking in their mind, oh, I should research other offers, or maybe this wasn't the best offer for me. I'm going to do a little bit of due diligence before I actually go through with the transaction. So you have that 3-day cooling off period. You have 3 days to obtain other estimates. I mean, I was just at a home improvement expo, a couple of them, in the last couple of months. And, you know, it's real tempting to sign up for these types of estimates and actually sign up to get work done. And so it's very important that you get your, you know, at least 2, 3, 4 estimates before you get major work done around your house or your condo, and to look up these companies through the Better Business Bureau or through the Ohio Attorney General's office to figure out their track record, just like you would if you were in any other setting. You know, you don't want to give up your money. You don't want to commit to anything without really knowing that you are getting value and you're getting the best deal for you. So it's real important that you do your research and that you keep your guard up and make sure that you do thorough consideration and be a skeptical if something sounds too good to be true.
So suppose that I feel I got scammed. I feel that what they were selling, they had indicated it was superior products, but I found out later it was inferior products. What would be my steps in contacting your office?
Well, my first step would be trying to work it out with the company, because some companies are willing to give you a refund or to negotiate a potential refund or partial refund. So it's really important that consumers try as best they can to tell the business their side of the story. Putting it in writing can be important with a deadline for them to resolve the issue. And if you can't work it out yourself, you are more than willing to contact the Attorney General's office through our toll-free number or through our website to get help. We have no ability to go to court on behalf of one consumer and one complaint, but we have every ability to use our informal dispute resolution process to try to work that to help consumers out. At the very least, you'll be at least making sure the business knows your side of the story. When they may not be as willing to hear from you individually, they may be willing or maybe more approachable to the Ohio Attorney General's office, doing it using our phones and our emails and our letters that we can do on behalf of the office. So don't give up if you can't resolve it yourself. You can file a complaint with our office. And then if that doesn't work, you can go to small claims court, or if it's of a higher value, a different court. But you always have your rights, and we can be there for you if you do have a complaint and you do want it resolved. And we can at least get in touch with that company as best we know how and get them to listen to your side of the story. What we cannot do is be a fact finder. We're not a court, so we can't tell you that you're lying or they're lying or they're a bad company or you're a bad consumer. But we will try to work out through our informal dispute resolution process a way for you to get hopefully a refund or whatever you think you deserve out of the situation.
Suppose I question the validity of a certain individual. Is there any way to do a background check real quick about that person?
It can be difficult because you certainly can't believe everything you see and read on the internet. But if you're sitting there with your smartphone, you can do some internet searches. You can search the name of a company along with words like complaint or scam and see what comes up. You can generally get a sense of their reputation, at least, or maybe some trends in what problems consumers may have with a particular company. Now, if you have some more time, you can go to our office. You can make a public records request. If we can't get you the information you need, simply through a search on our website at ohioprotects.org, you can make a public records request. And in a reasonable amount of time, you can get the full complaint from a consumer, minus any account numbers or social security numbers or anything like that. We can get you full complaints on what consumers have been alleging about a particular company. And you can also search our database online for any judgments we've gotten against the company or any lawsuits we filed against the company, which is especially helpful with home remodeling, home repair, maybe motor vehicle sales, things like that. You know, when you're at the state fair, when you're at a county fair or an independent fair, watch out for any deceptive displays or misrepresentations, because companies generally are required to provide consumers with all the facts prior to the sale. So if there is information that has to be noted in order for you to obtain the advertised price, you know, all that kind of information should be given to you up front before you actually make the purchase.
Do you have any tips that we sort of have to keep in mind? I know you've been giving a lot of different information, but you know, just sort of capitalize what we as individuals need to be aware of when we go to those different county fairs or state fairs and communicate with different businesses.
Yeah, I mean, the overarching theme of what I'm talking about really is, if it sounds too good to be true, it probably is. Be skeptical, ask questions, don't sign anything unless you've read the fine print and understand everything that it talks about. And if you don't understand it, don't sign it, don't give your money up, don't give up your personal information until you really understand everything you're reading. And if it takes a couple more days, if it takes you to visit the company's website, if it takes you to call a toll-free number, that may be a reason to pause and to wait until you have time to do your due diligence and to do your research. So be careful with your personal information. keep your guard up. If you have questions, ask them and get thorough answers before you give up your money or give up your personal information. It's being that skeptic that really is helpful, and to be asking the questions until you get the answers is important. And if you have other folks in your group, you know, take a huddle and figure out, you know, what good questions to ask, whether it's worth doing, what everybody is thinking about a certain deal before you sign up. Sometimes five or six or seven brains are better than one, especially when your money and your personal information is at stake. The Ohio Attorney General's Consumer Protection Section website is www.ohioprotects.org. That's ohioprotects.org. The big website for the entire Attorney General's office is www.ohioattorneygeneral.gov, ohioattorneygeneral.gov. And the toll-free number, no matter what section you're interested in, no matter what you want from the Attorney General's office, a great place to start is the Attorney General's Help Center. And it's open all the business days at 800-282-0515. And if you'd rather go online, you can even chat with people in our constituent services section through our website, through that ohioattorneygeneral.gov. You can chat with someone if you'd rather do that than a phone call or a message over the internet.
Should they ask for you?
Well, I'm not in the constituent services section, so I won't be the one helping them necessarily, but we have people that are armed with a jurisdictional database and lots of very important information at their fingertips so they can be as helpful as possible to each one of our constituents, because we are here to help.
Hey, we're talking with Ryan Lippe. Ryan Lippe is a consumer educator with the State of Ohio Attorney General's Office, Dave Yost. Ryan, great information, and hope to see you at one of the county fairs.
I'll be around, and thank you so much. And we're going to have information at some of our county fairs. We're going to be holding booths at some of our county fairs. And if you need a presentation from me to any of our organizations out there, church groups, Lions clubs, Kiwanis clubs, any of the Rotary, please give us a call at our toll-free number. We are available to travel as well as give virtual presentations to groups. So let us know if you need help in that regard as well. Thanks so much.
Any cost to that?
Absolutely not. Everything is free. We just do like to have at least 20 people in the audience, and it's better if it's during business hours. But, you know, with virtual presentations, there is no minimum requirement. So in terms of people, so we are able to accommodate even the smallest group through our virtual presentations that don't require traveling.
Ryan, thank you.
Thanks, Patrick. Appreciate it.